Hello, and welcome to today's webinar, Double Bass Pedagogy in the K-12 Classroom. My name is Heather Meyer, and I'll be running everything in the background for our session today. We are thrilled to host today's webinar with the American String Teachers Association. So let's get things started. I'm pleased to introduce today's presenter. Dr. Michael Hopkins is professor and chair of music education at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. He is a guest conductor at over 60 orchestra festivals in 20 states and given over 80 conference presentations on topics in string education. He is composed and arranged over 90 works for orchestra, including The Art of String Teaching, a pedagogy research published by GIA. And he's published articles in the Journal of Research of Music Education, American String Teacher, String Research Journal, Music Educators Journal, and other music education journals. Dr. Hopkins, thank you so much for being with us today.
Well, thank you for having me. All right. Welcome, everyone. This session, I'm going to focus on some tips and tricks that you can use to help your bass players in your orchestra classrooms. I have a slide deck I'm going to share. And whoops, hold on. Okay, here we are. So, got a lot of stuff I want to share with you about helping your bass players succeed. So, the way I'm going to organize this is start with some basic foundational things about playing the bass, because I often find when I go out into schools and I visit orchestra programs that what holds a lot of bass students back is there's something wrong with just the basic foundational way that they're playing the instrument. So I'm going to start with that, and then as we go on, I'm going to get into some more intermediate and advanced ideas. So, all right, so here we go. Let's see. Well, okay. So these are the topics I'm going to address today. Instrument position, then bow hold and bow stroke for double bass. Pizzicato technique, which is kind of special and different for bass. We have a few different types of things that we do that are different from the other orchestral strings. And then left hand position, which is so important because you want your bass players to play in tune, and to do so, they really need to have a good left hand position. And then I'm going to spend some time going over how to introduce your bassists to shifting. Because the way shifting is introduced in most class method books is the shift to third position, which is one of the worst shifts on the double bass. It's one of the hardest ones we do. So I'm going to give you some things that you can do with your bass players to set them up for shifting and some basic shifting principles, and then share some ideas on how to help your bassists with ear training, overall intonation and expression, and then show you some supplementary materials and talk about some equipment issues. And there's a handout, so hopefully you all have the handout. We can talk about that a little bit at the end. Okay, so the first one is instrument position, setting the end pin length. So the bass, as you know, is a very large instrument. So this is one of my former students, Lauren Phillips. She's Lauren Phillips now, and so she's holding the bass in front of her, and you can see what we want is when you face the bass, we want the knuckles, your middle knuckles right there, to touch the bridge like this. All right, that's the number one thing, because if that's where the bass is, then you're gonna be bowing in the right lane. Now the second consideration is the relationship of the nut to the eyebrows. Now, if you look at me, I'm standing with the bass and I'm looking straight ahead and my eyebrows are level with the nut. Now, if you look at Lauren, Lauren's not as tall as me, so the nut is a little bit above her eyebrows. It's more almost like even with the top of her head. Now, if you have some students who, are say in high school and you want to have them on a three-quarter bass, but they're, you know, maybe between you know, 5'2", 5'6", or something, this is probably what it's going to look like. And you can adjust the end pin down a little bit so that the nut is a little bit closer to their eye level. And it's really finding a balance of between this knuckles contacting the bridge and the nut being at eye level. But if you've got a student, so just check that with all your bass students that so that the, right off the bat, they have the correct end pin length. So next is the angle of the bass to the body. So the thing about the bass is we want to be able to comfortably reach both the E string and the G string, okay? The first string and the fourth string. And if the basic idea with the bass is here, I'll show you. When you're standing, you want to have this piece right here, where the back connects to the side, that right there where you can see my varnish is kind of rubbed off, that's what you want to touch your body right there. And you want to lean it in like this area right here. And what you don't want to do, let me show you some problems people have. So if you lean the side against your body like this, it feels great, you know, just, you know, leaning right there. And the G string, so easy to reach the G string there. But I can't play the E. If I play the E string right there, I quickly run into my leg. So that's why we want to have the bass, as you can see in the picture where Lauren leans it. I try to do this thing with my basses. It's kind of like a bass version of the Statue of Liberty. Hold it at about arm's length up here and then lean it in. And then look, Ma, no hands, okay? So it should balance. And if it's gonna fall, it's gonna lean, you want it to lean forward a little bit so that the weight goes into your bow, okay? And now the problem, the other problem people have is that if they stand behind the bass, you can reach the E string really easily if you stand behind the bass like this, if I'm kind of behind it. But the bass is very unbalanced and it's really hard to reach over to the G, and so kids tend to be like that. So that's why we have that. That's why we stand with the bass with this leaning right here against the body. And that allows us to reach all the strings really easily. So that's the second thing you want to check for. And then what I just showed you, what Lauren's doing here, the body balance trick, where with you stand, when you stand with the bass, you can let go. And if it's going to lean, you want it to lean forward. And the reason why you want it to lean forward has to do with gravity. If the bass leans forward, the weight of the bass, you're basically, the weight of the instrument comes into the bow. So it helps to produce tone. If the bass is leaning backwards, you're going to be supporting the whole weight of the bass with your left thumb. And I'll show you what happens coming up with that if you're holding it up with your left thumb. So we want to strive for body balance. The weight should be evenly distributed between your 2 feet, like you see in the picture of Lauren there. So balance between the 2 legs, the legs about shoulder width apart. And that is going to be the best way to stand. And so you want to use gravity, don't work against it. So if the bass is going to lean, lean it into your fingers, lean it into your bow. Don't lean it back on the thumb. If it leans back on the thumb when you're standing, then you're probably going to see kids doing this with their left hand. They're going to start reaching around and gripping it because they're just trying to hold the bass up. So try to use gravity. Think about the whole bass working with the earth, and we want to take advantage of those forces and not try to work against the forces of nature when we play the bass. By the way, this picture, I'm going to show you this again. This is Gary Carr, one of the most famous double bassists in the world, and some students. you know, performing a piece. And you can see how everybody's standing, they're balanced, but everybody looks a little bit different when they play because, you know, bases are big and people come in different shapes and sizes. So we've got to do whatever we can to get comfortable with this large instrument. Now, if you sit, and I'll get into the advantages of sitting versus standing in a minute, but I'm going to grab a stool here. So I've got just a garden variety, like a wooden stool that you can buy at Walmart. And the idea here is that the stool should be about level with the bottom of your pant pocket there. That's what you want to aim for. If that's where the base, the height of the stool, your students will be comfortable sitting on it. If it's too tall or too short, it's probably going to be difficult for them to get balanced and comfortable. So when you sit down with the bass, you want, like if you think about cello, one of the guidelines for cello is you want to see that C peg behind and below the left ear a little bit. On bass, you want it so the nut of the instrument is slightly above, slightly behind the left ear. So I can show you, I'll do a different, little slightly different angle from what you see in the pictures on the screen. So like this, the nut's a little bit behind and above your left ear. So that stool you see in the picture on the left, that's an adjustable stool. I recommend if you can afford to buy some metal adjustable stools for your program, that would be the best because then you can adjust the stools to different heights to accommodate students in your program, bassists who are all of different heights, so that if they sit down, they can be comfortable sitting down on a stool. I'm about 6 feet tall and this stool's perfect for me. So, you know, that means anybody who's less than 6 feet tall, the stool is going to be too high. Okay, as you can see in the picture on the last screen here where the left leg is supporting the weight of the instrument, and here's another picture on the right here where you can see Lauren supporting the weight of the instrument, and you can see Tommy there, the bass, leaning against the left leg. So just like with standing, we want to position the bass when we're sitting so that we can comfortably reach the E and the G. And I'll bring this down so you can see. So I want to be able to clear my leg. If I have it tilted too far like this, I'm going to run into my leg. I want to be able to clear my leg, but I also want to be able to reach the G. Be able to reach over there. And just like with cello, when you're sitting and you cross strings, there's a feeling that you are opening up the elbow so that you get a good angle on the G, because if you just go straight like that, the bow is going to be pointing at the ground by the time you get to the G, and we don't want that. Okay, so let's talk. I'm going to give a caveat here before I go into this. Most bass players spend some of their life standing and some of it sitting. It's very common for bassists, if they're doing a solo recital or playing chamber music, to stand and then to sit when they're playing in an orchestra. I personally like to stand when I'm playing in orchestra, and then I sit down if we have long periods of rest. I just like it because at my age, my back, it just helps my back. I don't know, when I sit on a stool for a long time, my back, my lower back starts to hurt. But everyone I play with, all the bass players I play with, they have kind of their different approach that they use. Some like to sit, some like to stand. So an advantage of standing is you can get some leverage into the bow, particularly with the German bow, by leaning the instrument into the bow. Okay, and it gives you freedom. You know, you're not sitting, so you can move around a little bit more, helps to free you of tension when you're playing. But sitting can be particularly advantageous if you're playing the French bow. So the French bow, if you think about it, so if you're playing the bass with the French bow, then you're gonna have more of a cellistic technique. And so you want, just like with the cello, you want the weight coming down into the instrument. So if you if you're sitting when you're playing the French bow, that can really help pull a bigger tone from the instrument. Sometimes the thing I see with a lot of kids when they're standing and playing with French bows, they start to get really kind of tense. The bow hand starts to get really not looking so good. And so if you sit a bassist down, if they're playing French bow, that can help. They can usually make a bigger sound. They can relax their bow hold a little bit. And like I said, a lot of bassists like to sit down for long rehearsals. So those are the advantages of both. Now, I just wanted to briefly talk about the sizing of double bass. Generally, if your students are under 5 feet tall, quarter size bass is what you're going to want. Half size basses work well for students who are between 5 and 5'5". And then 3/4, if your students are 5'6 or taller, definitely a 3/4. Now, one of the things with nomenclature for the bass is that the full size bass is a 3/4 bass. This bass that I'm playing on is a 3/4 bass. You almost never see a four bass. It has to do with the string length. There's some basses in being played in professional orchestras that are 7/8 size, but 3/4 is what most people play. And now, all this being said, the larger the basses do produce more sound. I find half-size basses are quite comfortable to play, but they tend to produce kind of a small sound compared to a 3/4. So if you have a student who, say, you know, they're done growing and they're 5'2 or 5'3, you're going to probably, you know, you're going to need to get them onto a 3/4 bass. And there are a lot of things that you can do to adjust and your hand and move your hand around. My stand partner, Erin Roberts, when I was in the University Symphony at Michigan back in the 90s, she was 5'3". She had a big bass. She was all over that thing. And so it just is a big instrument, and there comes a time in every bassist's life where they kind of need to move over to a 3/4. And that also being said, it's important to remember that 3/4 basses come in different sizes and shapes. Some come with nice sloped shoulders that make it easier to play and get around. The bodies are a little smaller. The string length is a little shorter, but it's still considered a 3/4. So just keep that in mind. If you have serious students, you know, who are going into high school or in high school and they need to buy a bass, if they go to a good bass shop, and there are good bass shops all over the country, and if they go into a shop, you know, they may need to travel a while to get to the shop, but then there will usually be a lot of basses to try, and they can find one that they really like the size and feel of. Okay, here we go. Bow. All right. I'm going to try to do this a little quickly because I'm got a lot to do. Okay, German bow. I am going to show you this. I'm going to put my bass down. What I discovered a long time ago is a lot of teachers don't know how the German bow is supposed to be held because it's so different from the French bow. So this is how you do it. Hold it in the left hand. Take your right hand like this and just put the frog right into your right hand. And then curve this thumb, put it right on the top in the middle of the stick. These two fingers are going to touch right next to the thumb, the index in the middle. So the middle's touching the frog, the index is touching the stick, and the pinky is going to come down here, and the tip of the pinky is going to touch the ferrule. Now it could touch back here, but you want it to be comfortable. And here's the thing, you've got the German bow between the thumb and the pinky, and you can flex it. Let's see if I can get this on the video. This is bringing back memories of teaching string techniques on Zoom in 2020. Okay, so there's that. Now the ring finger just floats. It doesn't do anything. It just floats. And here's the interesting thing. If I take my German bow hold away and I turn it like this, it looks a lot like a French bow hold, but it's angled this way. So we've got the bent thumb on the top, these two fingers touching, the pinky down here, the ring finger floating. Okay, and then this is the position the bow would be in when you go up bow, when you push up. And then for the finger flex, and which let's pretend like I'm putting a little bit of super glue on my fingertips, and then I pull away, but my fingertips stay. So that's your flex. So you've got pulling and pushing, down, up, down, up. And that's how this bow hold works. And that's where your flex comes in. And so you want to keep your fingers relaxed. Here's some of the problems people do when they play the German bow hold. They do that with their thumb. That won't work. They do this with their fingers. That won't work either. They do something weird, like they put the stick between their two fingers. I've seen this. That's really bad. This with that, or this one. That's fun, where they kind of loop their ring finger inside. So, you know, like that. Not good. The interesting thing is, though, you can actually still pull a pretty halfway decent sound on open strings if you're, you know, gripping it. You've got the caveman grip, but, you know, this is what we want to do. So I'll do it one more time. Palm there, bent, tap these two fingers, tap the pinky, flex it, pull, and push. And that's it, okay? So that's the German bow. All right, now the French bow. Okay, I have a confession to make. I started playing bass as a French bow player back in my late teens. I was electric bass player first, and then I started playing the double bass, and I learned with French bow. Never could get comfortable with French bow, which is interesting because I'm perfectly comfortable playing French bow on violin, viola, cello. Never could get comfortable playing French bow on the bass. I end up squeezing with my thumb too much and getting pain in my thumb and wrist. But so if you can see, I've kind of doctored up this to give myself a little more padding, make it a little more comfortable. But what we want is the C shape, nice C shape hand, curved thumb, just like a cello. It's very much like a cello. A little space between the fingers, curved windows, every joint bent in the direction it was intended to bend, okay? And there are people who play German, there are people who play French, there's plenty of bass players who play both. Let me see if I, yeah. Okay, so I'll just briefly, because this is always something, I don't see anything in the Q&A yet, but this is almost always something that comes up. If you are teaching in an orchestra classroom and your bass student is starting on French and they've got a teacher, they've got a private teacher, they've got someone who's keeping a close eye on them, making sure they develop a nice curved, relaxed bow hold, that's great. If you don't, I'm telling you that I struggled with French bow for almost a decade, and I was studying with Stuart Sankey at the University of Michigan in graduate school, and I was just telling him about the pain I was feeling. He sat me down, he put a German bow in my hand. We spent a couple weeks with him showing me how to do it. I've had no pain, and it's been super comfortable for me ever since. So that's my story. So I obviously am a little bit biased here. But one thing I can tell you is that German bow for kids is often, it's easier for them to get a big sound with a relaxed bow hold quickly. But again, it depends on your level of expertise. A lot of orchestra teachers I meet just like having the bases on French bow because then it's like all the other bows. And I get that, you know, because some of the bow exercises that we do just don't translate well to German bow. But if you have a kid who's playing French and they're getting all cramped and tense, maybe move them over to German bow. And I think that you'll find that they're comfortable with it. They can play, they can get a nice sound, and it's not hard for them. So how do you choose a good German bow? There's a question. Same way you choose a good French bow, I guess. It's the same thing. You know, there are cheap bows, then there are middle priced bows, and then there are bows that are in the $800,000 range, and then, you know, and on and up. A decent carbon fiber bow that's, you know, in that, $200 to $300 price range or even less, that's probably going to be fine for, a middle school kid, a high school kid who's really serious and wants to audition for Allstate. You know, a good carbon fiber bow in the $800 to $1,000 range is going to be fantastic. It'll allow it to bounce. It'll be a great bow for them. Obviously, if you get into wood bows, you can get a lot more expensive than that. But another question, how curious about French and German bows. How do these styles come about? So, that's a good question. The French bow is a torque bow. So that really is it's a large version of a torque bow. This underhand frog, if you can trace that back to the Gamba family, and there's some interesting things about the bass, the history of the bass. And there's a great book, if you really want to geek out on it, there's a book by Paul Bruhn called The History of the Double Bass. Basically, the issue with the bass is that the instrument is so big, and before there were steel strings and it was gut strings, there was just all kinds of experimentation with tuning and size and shape and design. And when you look at basses, there are, like, if you look at the back of my bass, it's curved, but there are a lot of basses that have flat backs that look very Gamba-like in the back. And Paul Bruhn basically just concludes that there's just a lot of sort of genealogical borrowing that went into the bass compared to some of the other strings. You know, the other one in the string family where there's been a lot of experimentation over time is with the viola. So anyway, all right, I'm going to go on. To help them learn the correct bow hold and keep a relaxed bow hold. Okay, so sure. So with German bow players, what you want to do is have them form the bow hold, hold the bow in the left hand, you know, form the bow hold, transfer it to the string in the middle of the bow, and then have them push up, stop, and then add a little weight in, and then pull. And what we're looking for, and this, I'm going to get to the next screen because this is all on the next screen. We want to have a little bit of bite in a bass tone. Did you hear that? That articulation. We want to get out that because that's how you set the string, the fundamental in. If we don't have that little bit of bite, that articulation at the beginning, we get that kind of transient where we're getting more of the overtones in the string than the fundamental. There's a good one. If we go down, you can hear that. So what we want is to stop, add the weight. So it's basically, it's like a martelet stroke is what it is, you know, on a bass. Everything's got a little bit of that in it, a little bit of bite. One of the things with bass is that you want the speed of the bow to move slowly, especially on the A and the E. If you move the bow, you know, one of the things, especially violinists, they like to teach their beginners to use more bow, use more bow. That's kind of a disaster for bass players. The more bow all the time, because the faster you move your bow down here, the less focused the sound gets. Whereas if I slow it down and add weight, now on the G, there we go. I can move it faster. The arm motion, let's see if I can show you my arm. It's swinging. Think armpit air, open and close. One of the problems I see with kids sometimes is they turn their elbow in, they kind of, and they hug their body with their elbow, or they sort of twist their arm in like that. So a difference between bass and cello is that your arm, your elbow is more extended on bass than on cello. It's more open, but you still have the wing. The elbow isn't tucked under. It's still out and you're swinging. It's still a swinging, open and closing motion, armpit air coming, you know, opening and closing. And so we wanna teach that. So at the beginning, stop, get a good sound, and slow speed, a swinging arm motion, and then it's a big instrument, but it doesn't make a big sound. You have to really encourage students to play with a big sound. There's almost never enough bass players in school orchestras. So encourage your bass players to develop a big tone. If they're getting scratchy, thin tone, poor response, here's some things to check. So first of all, I'm gonna put this down on the bowing area. The 1/16th rule is that you should bow, the optimal place to bow a string is 1/16th of the vibrating length. Well, when you have an open bass string, that's actually really close to your fingerboard. But if your bass player shifts up here, plays the D scale, there, it really needs to be more here. And if they go, you know, if you're doing high school and you're having them do 3-octave scales, by the time you get up to here, you're really down near the bridge. So it's like all the other strings, it's just, it's bigger, right? So you got the, it's, you're gonna see more. So just listen for that if they're getting kind of a scratchy tone. Could also be if as they cross, they're not adjusting to move the bow parallel to the bridge. S- again, slowing the bow down. And then another thing that happens with basses, because they're often shared in schools, is the, you know, either the bows don't get rosined enough or they're over rosined. A lot of times kids don't clean the rosin off the strings. And so you gotta, it really builds up. And if it, the rosin is really caked on the strings, it's hard to get the strings to respond. So just look at that. Okay, pizzicato. So there's two kinds of pizzicato. If we're gonna do bluegrass or jazz or something, we wanna do a vertical, point your fingers towards the bridge, and you're gonna do a rest stroke. You're gonna take your finger and you're gonna pluck it into the string below. That's why it's called rest. You rest it on the string below. Okay, and that's the style we use in jazz or bluegrass. Okay, so we do that kind of pizzicato. We don't hold the bow. We put the bow down. And then free stroke pizzicato is when we're typically holding the bow, and you want to pits, you know, about 6 inches from the end of the fingerboard, and it's free floating. You know, I'm playing you guys know the tune, right? Yeah, I'm playing the Nutcracker. So we want it to be free floating. One of the things that sometimes can help is if basses pit or vibrate when they pits, that can warm things up a bit. And then the only other thing I want to show you about bass pizzicato is if you look down here, I've got this little thing I bought that attaches onto the tailpiece called a bow quiver. They're not that expensive to buy, and I can just put my bow down in the quiver if I have an extended pizzicato passage, which bass players often do. It's kind of a nice thing, and then you don't have them plopping their bows down on the music stand. So if you have a few basses and you can afford, you know, $15-$20 per bass to put bow quivers on them, it's kind of a nice thing to have for bass players. Okay. The left hand. So, all right, everyone there at home, try this with me. I learned this game from Rosemary Petzl about 35 years ago. So we're going to do a bass face. We're going to take our thumb, our left thumb, put it gently into our ear, then we're going to take our middle finger, touch it to our nose, and then we're going to, it's funny, I'm going to take my glasses off for this. Okay, and then we're going to take our index finger, touch it between our eyebrows, and then our ring finger, touch it to your upper lip, and touch your pinky to your below your lower lip there, and then just take it away, and that's the bass player's hand. That's called bass face. And that's what the hand should look like. It looks a little bit like a cello extension hand. So if you have it right, you've got your thumb behind the neck or posed from the second finger, and then you've got your first finger extended back a little bit. And on the next screen, I'll explain why you need to do that. So what you want to avoid is the hitchhiker thumb, where it's sticking up like this, or the wrap the thumb around the instrument. We want to keep that open, C-shaped. Often say, reach out, grab the grapefruit of truth and knowledge, and come on in and tap your fingers and get that shape. Okay, it's very important. The reason we have this extended, this finger thing is because if we kick the third finger out, because we don't use third finger by itself in the low position. Three works with four. So I take three out. I want to see the same distance between one and two as between two and four. And so that's what we're looking for. Oh, there's a rosin question. You're going to have to wait for that one. Jordan, I'll get to rosin. That is a big topic. That's what bass players like to sit around and talk about, you know, over cocktails, is rosin talk. Okay, shifting. So what you want to do is teach all your students to find the middle harmonic. Flop the hand down. Just flop it over the bow, touch the third finger. There's the middle harmonic. That's really important to do. You can do a harmonic song at the very beginning. And on and on. Okay, then you want to teach your students the neck block. So you put your thumb in the neck block. This is called fourth position. And your hand will be, your first finger will be a perfect fifth above the open string. This is a very important position for bass. Here's the note. So on the G string, you're going to have D, D and E, D, E flat and E. On the D string, A, B flat and B. On the A string, E, F, F sharp, and then on the E string, B, C, C sharp. And these are, this is a very important position. It's the most important position for bass other than first position. So we want to teach this. And before you get to the D major scale in the method book, teach them this song. I'm going to show it to you on the next screen in notation. This is called Twinkle Twinkle Seven Shifts. So we start in the neck block, do all those notes on the D, then we play open G and shift back to first position to finish it. You just shift up, always for the A. And it's a great, easy shift. That neck block is just solid. It's right there. And so teach that shift first. The next shift that you should teach your basses is the second position shift. And the way that works, so here's first position, D, E, and F sharp. What you do is you substitute your second finger for your fourth finger. So you put your second finger where your fourth finger was, and that allows your fourth finger to play on the D string. It would be G. It'll match the open G, hopefully. Okay, then you can do like Bylum Cabbage down. What's sometimes called the monkey song or up and down the ladder. Okay, so the bass players can be like everybody else and play all of that on one string if you show them second position. And if you show them fourth position and second position just by ear, just like I just showed you, before they get to that page in the method book where they need to do third position, then it'll make sense. Here's how I approach that third position shift. I have them play the open A string with the shift to second position. And then I go over and we start on first finger on the G. One, four, two, four. And we do the shift to third position. So if you do that, if you teach the middle harmonic, you teach fourth position, you teach second position, then when the basses, when they get to that book page in the book, they've got a fighting chance to be able to do that third position shift. Here's the notation for the twinkle twinkle seven shifts. It's real simple. It's a simple idea, and it's super helpful for students. Okay. Now, your students are getting more advanced, and here's some basic shifting ideas I want to share with you, because your bass players are going to shift a lot. There's only three scales on a bass that you can play with no shifting. G major in first position. And then there's F in half position. B flat in half position. And that's it. Those are the only scales you can play on a bass without any shifting. And so your bass players are going to shift early and often. So how do you go about setting aside time to teach basses? Yeah, so you can, what you can do is you can, what a lot of people I know do is they give their students, while everybody's in class, if it's just you and you've got, say, 30 students or something in your orchestra or more, a lot of teachers I know give individual practice time right there in class, let students work on something that they're aiming towards. A lot of the teachers I know will have like goals they set out for students, like, I want you to learn these scales and let me know when you're ready, I'll come around and check you off. And while you're doing that, you can go back and you can spend some time with your bass section showing them this stuff. I'll also share with you some supplementary materials that you can use to give to your basses to do as some home practice assignments or something like that. But you can do it. And you know, it's like, you know, all the instruments are different. Bass is just, you know, I guess you could say bass is the most different. But if we get them going, my concern is that since they have to shift so often, that if we don't address that really important component of their technique early, then they don't really learn how to shift correctly, and then it causes problems. So anyway, when you're shifting, you want to use the least number of shifts and the smallest shifts that you can. So, for example, how about this? So I have this, let's see. That's a little song called Song of the Wind. Sometimes it's called Fox and Goose. It's in a lot of method books. It's in the Suzuki books. Notice that I play up. Have to go to the D here, and I go to the neck block. I put my first finger, but instead of shifting back for the B and the A, once I've shifted up to the D, I stay in position and cross strings. So I can do this whole thing with one shift. I'll give you another example here. Say I want to do a D major arpeggio, okay? So I could do it with some big shifts like this. And then I've got this, after I play the A, I have this really big awkward shift to that D. And you know, it's you can get it, but it's just, the odds of you missing that shift are kind of a lot. But watch this, I can do this. D, and I can play the F sharp on the A string up here, and then, and I have no shifting, and I can do that whole arpeggio. Or If I put my first finger where my fourth finger was on that F sharp, then I have a very tiny shift to the A. And both of those ways of doing the D arpeggio are preferable to this. Because we want to avoid a really, really large awkward shift. So that's like something you want to think about when you're showing bass players stuff. And I'll give you an example here coming up. How much time do I have? Okay, don't have a lot of time. But I'm going to show you, the advice my teacher gave me in grad school. If you try a fingering three times and you're still out of tune, try a different fingering. It's good advice for bass players. Okay, tuning with harmonics. So you play up the D string, and then you just touch your fourth finger. That's A220. And then if you touch your first finger to the A string, you get the same pitch. And if you cross your fingers over and you play fourth finger on the A and first finger on the E, you get the same pitch. And then you finally go over to the D. And what you want to do is you want to do it with one bow stroke down, let it ring, and come back and turn the peg while it's ringing. And that's how professional bassists tune. And you can teach your young students that. Certainly by the time they're in their second year, you can teach them where those harmonics are. And they can be trying to do that while you're showing the other students how to work the fine tuners and all that. Because that's one of the things that's nice about the bass is we don't have tension pegs. We have mechanical pegs. They're easy to turn and they don't slip. Okay. Where was that Corelli excerpt? There it is. Okay. I want to get to that. Then we got to get to rosin. Okay. So bass is hard to play in tune, but it's really, really important for your bassist to play in tune because the intonation of your whole orchestra depends on it. So one of the things with bass that you can teach them, hopefully you can see this, is if I play my low G, and it's in tune, my open G actually vibrates with it. You can really see the sympathetic vibrations on a bass really easily. So we check that. There's lots of notes. Like if I play this E, where is it? No ringing. There, you hear the ringing. No ringing. Ringing. Same thing, like I hear this A. If I play it, no ringing, I get ringing. So you want to listen for the ringing tones, the resonance, the sympathetic vibrations. Check with the teacher basses to hear that. Everybody else has two open strings. Perfect fifths. Listen for that. That really helps you know where your first position is on the bass. And then, of course, in the neck block, checking the octaves. And things like that. Melodic intervals like open G. Here comes the bride. To check that where that C is. Little things like that can be super helpful. I'm going to get to the rosin question because Blair has just appeared. So here's these are my suggested supplementary things. Get the Vance Progressive Repertoire Book 1. Get the Suzuki Book 1 if you want to help your students who are beginners. These Vance has Book 2 and Book 3. Takes you from Twinkle all the way through the Dragonetti Concerto. The Suzuki Bass School has many volumes as well. They're nice solos. They're short. They're easy. There's great teaching tips in the book for how to introduce, how to preview the stuff. The semandal, that is the old school, kind of tried and true. The bass is like a house that you build. And, you know, and it's, but the exercises are like eating your vegetables, but it's very, very good for bass players. I love these progressive and compatible trios, quartets, duets, because they have them for basses, and so it's real nice. They work well. And then these new books by Galen McCord are great etude books for bass. And this is all in addition to the stuff that is for classrooms, like the habits books, the sound innovations, the essential elements, the advanced technique, all that stuff works great. Okay, rosin. There's a question about rosin, Blair. So I just got to answer the rosin question and then I think we're done. You know what? I'll make these slides available, because one of the things I didn't get a chance to talk about was I fingered this Corelli from the Christmas Concerto with some, you know, fingering suggestions, so participants could see like these ideas of small shifts and you know, good like idiomatic shifts for bass kind of written out in a part. So I've got that. But now the rosin. So, I mean, there's different, obviously, this is a very personal thing for bass players. I like the pops. It's super sticky. If you teach middle school, it's great for melting over pancakes and serving to your bass section. No, I'm just kidding. I knew a kid once who ate a whole thing of this, and, you know, talk about constipation. Not good. But it works well. It's super sticky. It melts. It like, I mean, just you can see on the drive home from the shop, it kind of melted on me a little bit. It's like maybe 75 degrees, it starts to melt. So if you're in Texas, maybe this isn't the right stuff. But in northern climates, I like the Carlson. I've always liked the Carlson Swedish bass rosin. It's a darker rosin. And it's real nice. It's treated me well over the years. Kolstein makes a nice rosin. A lot of bass players like the Kolstein dark. You know, in cooler climates, the dark stuff is good. It's you know, the stories orchestra teachers have about bass players and the rosin is just, it's always just hilarious. You know, like teachers have to lock the rosin up because, you know, the bass players will eat it or it disappears. They don't know where it goes. But anyway, yeah, that's what I would get either Pops, Carlson, Kolstein, something sticky. And, you know, I've never actually done this myself, but there is, you know, there is an unspoken rule that when you rosin a bass bow, you go in one direction only. You go from frog to tip because it's so sticky that if you go tip the other way, you could pull the plug right out. The rosin that's so sticky, it could pull the plug out of the bow. So go frog to tip. If you teach in a school, you may have, I would not let every single class period rosin the bows. You know, you just don't have that much rosin on the bows. So maybe have a designated class that, you know, each quarter gets to rosin the bows or something, but, you know, watch out for over rosining. Okay. That's it. I'm sorry.
No, you're fine. Mark Morton always recommended Nyman in West Texas because it was so dry. So that's what we used with our bases in that particular climate as well.
Yeah. So if it works, you know, talk to local bass players in your area, what they like, you know. And but it's really funny. Bass players really get into rosin.
So friends, thank you so much for your time. I know we've gone a little bit over. Heather will update the Alfred links that are in your chat. But if you're also interested in professional development from the American String Teachers Association, take your phone out real quick and grab this QR code so that you can also take our survey as well. We're super excited and elated to be able to collaborate with Alfred, for this is our third webinar in our series. And thank you so much, Dr. Hopkins, for giving us so much to think about and to move forward with. We put a couple links to the Bruins text and things like that as you were talking about those things. If you do have any additional questions, you can email us at the links and emails that were provided. With that said, thank you so much, friends. Heather, did you have anything else to add?
Thank you, everybody. We'll send that replay out when we have it, and we'll also include the link to that resource slide then when we upload it as well. So
thank you so much, Dr. Hopkins. Everybody have a great night. Bye.